Scripture reading comes from 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 16 to 17. 1 Peter 2, 16 to 17. And it says, "Act as free men, and do not use your freedom as a cover-up for evil, but use it as bond slaves of God. Honor all people, love the brotherhood, fear God, and honor the king." I'm going to welcome Bob to come and share the word with us today. Let me pray for you. Father, thank you for Bob. Thank you for his life. Thank you for his testimony. Thank you that you have appointed him to share the truth of your word with us. Lord, may you use him as a vessel, a noble vessel set aside for the master's use. May your word come forth with power and conviction. May you anoint him, Lord. And may the seeds of your word find hearts that are prepared, that are hungry for you. And Father, may you empower us, not just to hear it, but to live in obedience to it, and to have our hearts and our lives reflect the word of God so that we may grow and mature and bear fruit, the kind of fruit that lasts. For we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Martin. I'd like you all to imagine, if you will, that you're 4 or 5 years old. That might seem hard for more of you than others, but that's okay. Just imagine you're about 4 or 5 years old, and your mother has taken you shopping. She's holding your hand, you go into the store. And after you enter the store, you find yourself alone, and you're in an aisle. And on the shelves in that aisle are a row of glass jars filled with candy. And one of those jars has your absolute favorite sweet in it. Nobody's around, your mother's not there. What would you do? What would you do? I found myself in this situation at this age. My mother had taken my sister and me shopping. We went to a store, there was this candy. And my sister wasn't around, and I could reach the jar, and I didn't ask myself if it was right or wrong to reach my hand in and take out a handful. I just knew that I could, so I did. And the next thing I knew, my sister was standing right next to me. That's big sisters do, yeah? "I'm gonna tell on you." And I was too naive to worry about what my mother might do. And I wasn't embarrassed, I wasn't ashamed, and I just kept on eating these chocolate-covered raisins. My favorite. Maybe some of you like those as well. But my mother did find me, and she was very angry. And she took my hand, and she walked me to the cashier, and she looked me in the face after she told this woman what I had done, and said, "Now pay the lady for what you took. Pay her for the food that you stole." And all of a sudden, my perspective changed. I realized that I did not have the ability as a five-year-old to pay for that candy. And then there was a price to pay for my actions. It says in 1 Corinthians 13:11, "When I was a child, I talked like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put childish ways behind me." We'll get back to this story a little bit later. But tonight, I'd like to look at three key points in relation to the paradox of Christian freedom. What does it mean to be free as a follower of Jesus? How do we live as people who are free? It's a good question. Freedom seems like an easy word to define. And the New Testament talks a lot about freedom, doesn't it? If we look at John chapter 8, verses 31 and 32, there's a well-known verse that many of us have heard. Even unbelievers know this quite well. So Jesus said to the Jews who had believed him, quote, "If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." Everybody wants to be set free. Prisoners want to be set free. We want to be set free from our jobs. We want to be set free from difficult situations. But what does it mean when the truth sets us free? The definition can be found in Romans 8, verse 2. And it says this, "Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit of life set me free from the law of sin." Amen. "And death. Now we have eternal life and we have this relationship with the Father. We have forgiveness of sins." So forgiveness of sins, this is one area that we are free in as Christians. That's a good thing, isn't it? That's what we're looking for. But Romans chapter 6, verse 22 goes a step further. And it says this, "But now that you have been set free from sin and have become slaves of God, the fruit you get leads to sanctification and its end, eternal life." So there's this concept of being set free, but also becoming a slave. Now you might ask yourself, how can we be called slaves when the New Testament also says we're sons and daughters of the Most High God? We are his children. We are his friends. Well, the word that's used here in 1 Peter 2:16, servants of God, in the Greek is doulos. Maybe you've heard the word doulos before. And it's a bond slave, a slave who does not have ownership of themselves. They don't have any rights in any way. But it's used with the highest dignity in the New Testament. It means that you are bond slaves of the Most High God. You are no longer a slave to sin. So believers who are free, people who are free, are willingly living under the service, under the authority of Christ as a slave. So it raises the understanding of what it means to be a slave for Christ. Now, just to say briefly, the context of 1 Peter is important, I think. One of the main themes of this book is to endure suffering. Peter is speaking to the church in the known world, and he's saying to these believers, endure suffering and endure persecution. In 1 Peter verses 6 through 9, chapter 1, he says that those who suffer as Christians will be exalted later on. If you endure for now, there is something greater to come. So suffering is a part of being a slave, part of being free, actually. And he reminds them how Christ himself suffered unduly. 1 Peter 2, verses 22 and 23, he says, "Jesus was not guilty of the things that he was accused of, and yet he suffered for us." And this is contradictory to a prosperity gospel that many of us have heard before, that when you come to Christ, you'll be successful financially. Things will work out for you. That could be, but it has nothing to do with our faith. It has to do with God's grace on us. So we can suffer. And also, finally, I want to say that many of the people in the letter of 1 Peter who received it, they were Gentiles. They were not Jews. So to be free means to be a bond slave, and it means that we may endure suffering and persecution. But what about free will? What is free will, and is it the exact same thing as freedom. Well, I want to give you an analogy of when I was a teenager, and this is a true story. For all of the years I was a teenager, my father had his own business, and he was in sales. And once a year, he would take a hotel and rent out almost all of the rooms, and his business partners would come, and they would be there Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And they would have meetings, and I didn't have to attend the meetings. But during those 3 days, I could do what I wanted, I could eat what I wanted, and I could explore wherever I wanted. What do you mean by that, Bob? I'll tell you. What I could do was, I could go to the swimming pool, I could go to the game room, where we had pinball machines and video games, Pac-Man, things like that. I could play hide and seek all over the hotel, I could play tag, we could have elevator races. Anybody ever had elevator races before? You need at least two. You need at least two elevators. And I could eat what I wanted as well. I had a key with a number on it, back when they used to actually put your room number on the key. And you would go to the restaurant and have breakfast, lunch, and dinner with your friends, because the business partners brought their kids as well. And I would order what I wanted, and when the meal was done, I would sign my name and give the key. And they would say, "Yes, Mr. Kerr, thank you very much." And my father would pay for the hotel room and all the food that I ate for the whole weekend on Sunday evening. That was a sweet deal. It was a good deal. And I could explore wherever I wanted. So when we arrived on Friday night, my friends and I would run around the hotel and check out every single room, every single elevator, every single exit, where you can go, where you can't go, where's the pool, where's everything that you need to know. Every single fire escape, every place. The hotel was mine for 3 days. But there were rules. My father would give me a $10 bill and say, "Here, these are 40 quarters for you to play games in the game room. And when they run out, that's it, no more money." And I had to dress nicely. I couldn't just wear jeans and a t-shirt. Why? Because I represented my father, and he was important. All the people in that hotel knew that I was Bruce Kerr's son. "Oh yeah, you're Bruce Kerr's son. I'm so glad none of you call me that here." But for many years, I was Bruce Kerr's son. I still am, but that's not my title. And I had to dress nicely because my father would always say, "Remember who you are. Remember what your family name is. It's Kerr. You are part of the Kerr family, and when you do something bad, you represent me, and it embarrasses me. So dress nicely, act appropriately." For example, one night with my friend in the hotel, we went from the top floor to the lobby, and we decided on the way down, let's shout the worst curse words we can possibly say. I would say one, he would say one, and I would say one. And the idea was, when the door opened in the lobby, the one who got caught saying it got in trouble. But when we got down into the lobby, what we didn't realize is people could hear us all the way down. And when it opened, a good friend of my father's, a woman, her eyes were like this, and she gave me this look. And I knew that I was in trouble, that I had not represented my father well. So what's my point? I could do what I wanted, but there were consequences for my actions. There were rules. I was given a balance of authority because of who I was, because I was a guest in the hotel, but I had responsibility to deal with this authority properly. Now, Adam and Eve in the garden were in a similar situation. Follow me here. God created Adam and Eve, and he placed them in the garden, and he gave them free will. It says in Genesis chapter 2 and verse 7, "The Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And the man became a living being." In verse 15, "The Lord God took the man, put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it." Now, I won't go into depth in everything here, but finally in verse 16, it says this, "And the Lord God commanded the man, 'You are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil.'" For when you eat of it, you will surely die. And this applied to Eve as well. Unfortunately, Adam and Eve took advantage of the free will that they had. They sinned. They did something that they should not have. They ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. It wasn't an apple tree, as some people assume. But there were rules as well. God gave them authority, but he also said, you shouldn't eat from this tree. And if you look at chapter 1, starting in verse 28, the Lord gave them some things, some responsibilities to do in the garden. He said, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. That sounds like an easy job. Have kids, fill the earth. Sounds like a good responsibility. He said just after that, subdue the earth. The Garden of Eden was different from the rest of the earth. And they were to go out and subdue the rest of the earth. And he said also, have dominion over it and everything that moves. The animals are yours. I want you to have authority over the animals and all of these things. And have the plants for food. It seems back then people were vegetarian. But I'm sure they didn't complain. So what is the point I'm trying to say about Adam and Eve in the garden here? As humans, we were designed to do something here on the earth. We were designed to image God, to represent him on the earth. The mountains, the hills, the plants, the animals, they were his creation. But we alone were made in a unique way to be his imagers, so we could represent him on the earth. Dr. Michael Heiser, who wrote a book called The Unseen Realm, had this to say about us representing God here on the earth. He said, we do this by means of a spectrum of abilities we have as humans. These abilities are part of our being like God. Not actually being little gods, as some people teach, but being like God. And these are attributes we share with God, such as intelligence, creativity. And one of these attributes is freedom, free will that reveals itself in decision-making. If humanity had not been created with genuine freedom, representation of God would have been impossible. They could not accurately image him. So part of who you are is your ability to make a choice. And you can make a choice because God wanted you to be that way. He wanted you to be able to say, I can do good or I can do bad. And since Adam and Eve were designed to be like God, they could choose between right and wrong, just like you and me. And we face the same challenge today. To live as free people, but to not sin. To be bondservants of God. So like me in the hotel, if you can put this together, they could do whatever they wanted, but there were consequences for their actions. They were given this balance of authority and responsibility in the Garden of Eden. Now, I'm not going to argue if free will is real or not. I'm not going to get into Calvinism and all of these theological arguments, but some people will say this, if Adam and Eve really sinned, and this resulted in the creation and fall of man, and God made them and he gave them free will, isn't it God's fault? Because he knew that they were going to make these mistakes. Isn't it his fault that sin came into the world? He could have stopped it. Maybe you've thought this, maybe you've heard this. And I want to ask a question first before I answer that. How many people here have teenagers or older? Okay, very good. Your kids, if they aren't already, get to a certain age where you want to be able to trust them, yes? And when you trust them, you have to give them tests. And one of the tests will be, we're going out for dinner tonight, my wife and I, my partner and I, and we want you to stay home to be without us and don't burn the house down. So what are the basic rules? No candles, no matches, no friends over the house, go to bed by a certain time, don't play football in the house. Sounds like good rules, yes? Good rules. Okay, but when you come home, the kids are all in bed. Very strange. And you find out the dustpan and brush and your lamp is missing. When you get the kids out of bed and you find out that they decided to play football, soccer in the house and they broke a lamp. Let me ask you, whose fault was it that the lamp broke? Was it your fault? It's not a tough question. It was the kids' fault, right? They broke it. They broke it. If they played football and broke the lamp, it was their fault. You see, allowing someone to exercise free will is an act of love. And I want to make this point. Now, of course, you want your kids to be responsible because sometimes you just need to get out of the house. But really, you want them to be responsible because you love them. But it's risky, isn't it? It's risky loving somebody and trusting them. And God chose to show his love to us by giving us free will. Even when he knew that we would make a mistake, even when he knew that Adam and Eve would make wrong choices, and when you would make a wrong choice. Love and trust are intimately connected with one another. And that's why when we don't trust our children, or anyone for that matter, they question our love for them. And this is something I've come to understand as a parent, and I'm still learning, because it's hard to let your kids grow up. But we need to trust people. And when we do, it shows them that we love them. So how did the Corinthians handle free will? How did they deal with this freedom that they had? And I'd like us all, please, to turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And as you're turning to 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 12, I'm going to tell you a little bit about the city of Corinth. At the time of the writing of this letter, Corinth was a Roman city, completely Roman. So the people there were Gentiles. They didn't grow up understanding what the Word of God was in the Old Testament. They didn't know the Ten Commandments. They lived in homes that had many, many gods. They had altars. They had little idols. They woke up in the morning and they made sacrifices to these idols. They had idol sacrifices throughout the day. They had gods with many celebrations that took place throughout the year. And they had people who traveled around the Roman Empire who were speakers, orators, people who you would have to pay money to go see, and they would speak in the Colosseum or some local place. And among other things, they would tell you how to get higher in the social ladder of the Roman society. So the Corinthians worshiped many gods, and they wanted to improve their lives. They wanted to become better people, and they paid money for that. And these people who spoke maybe were what we would call these days, what's the word, Jonathan? On the internet, people. Influencers, thank you. Influencers. Okay, and an influencer can be someone who has a YouTube channel, it can be a movie star, it can be a singer, but they influence society. They're an important part of pop culture. And Corinth was filled with ungodly pop culture. Now let's start reading here in chapter 6, verse 12. It says, "Everything is permissible for me, but not everything is beneficial. Everything is permissible for me, but I will not be mastered by anything. Food for the stomach and stomach for the food, but God will destroy them both." Now, I read this for years thinking these were all the words of Paul. But there's a catch here. If you look at verse 12 in the beginning, where everything is permissible for me, it's in quotations. Who sees quotations in your Bible with that phrase? There are quotations there. But when it says, but not everything is beneficial, there are no quotations. Again, everything is permissible for me, quotations. But I will not be mastered by anything, no quotations. But the stomach, food is for the stomach and the stomach for the food, quotations. But God will destroy them both. The body is not meant for sexual immorality, but for the Lord, no quotations. What Bible scholars and theologians will tell you are these quotations represent Paul talking about a slogan, a catchphrase that was popular at that time. People believed this and they used this. So let me say it a bit differently. Extra words added by me. You say everything is permissible for me, but I say, Paul, not everything is beneficial. You say everything is permissible for me, but Paul, I will not be mastered by anything. You say food for the stomach and stomach for the food, Paul, but God will destroy them both. So Paul is using their beliefs. He's using their understanding. He's using their slogans to teach them. He doesn't just throw it out and say, this is stupid. He says, you say this and I say that. He's trying to teach them what the Word of God says, what God wants them to believe and to understand. And the problem was, there was a difficulty within the city of Corinth, among other things, prostitution. People would normally visit prostitutes on a regular basis before they became Christians. So when they became Christians, it was normal for them to continue to use prostitutes. They believed the body and the spirit were very different. That when you got saved as a Christian, your spirit went to heaven. But because the body was evil, according to their teachings, if you ate something or drank something or slept with anybody, it didn't matter. You follow me here? It was okay for them. And Paul had to continually speak against this. The church was using this slogan and their freedom as an excuse to sin, which is the warning we have in 1 Peter not to do this. And in chapter 10, he again discusses this about what you should eat and what you should drink. So what is the danger of a slogan? A slogan is often a piece of truth, and that truth is based on a popularly held belief. And the final slogan that we have becomes what we declare as truth. And this is subject to people's emotions. So when you say everything is permissible, you're making an excuse for what you did. Now, back in the early 2000s, there was a popular phrase. It was a very simple one, and it went like this. It's all good. Maybe you've heard this before. Maybe you've used it before. I used to work with some guys doing landscaping. And they'd get drunk on a Wednesday night and come in Thursday morning, and they wouldn't be good for anything. And I'd say, guys, get drunk on the weekends, at least, please. And they'd say, ah, Bob, it's all good. Chill out. It's all good. So they're using this phrase to justify their actions. So what about this? Imagine you're invited over Nick and Grace's house for dinner, and you're really excited because you've heard that Nick tells funny jokes and Grace has wonderful food, but you just want to be with them and you want to tell them a little bit about your life and you hope they'll pray for you afterwards. And you sit down at the table and Nick brings out a liter of wine. A liter of wine. And he opens it up and says, you don't mind, do you? And you're like, oh no, that's okay. And you may or may not drink. And they go through a liter of wine and then they bring out another bottle and they drink some more wine. And when they're all done, they've drunk 3 bottles of wine and they're really happy. And you feel a bit uncomfortable. This is an example. I've never experienced this myself. And you say, you know, Nick, is this okay for Christians to drink so much? And Nick says, it's all good. What would you think? And you say, okay, fine. And you hope that you'll have some prayer time afterwards. And you retire to the living room. And Nick says, hey, I just got this great DVD from the UK. You're going to love it. And he puts it in and you start watching this movie. And there's an extreme amount of violence in the film. People are being shot. People are being stabbed. People are dying. There are extreme off-color jokes, bad language, and scenes of sexual immorality in the film. And it makes you extremely uncomfortable. And when it's all done, you get Nick on the side and you say, is it okay for us to watch films like this? And he's like, chill out. It's all good. What would you think? You see, we can't make excuses for our actions if something is wrong. And we can't use slogans to excuse how we live our lives. I want to give an example, and I don't want to judge anybody by this, but there's a phrase in the Bible many of you have heard, and many of you know, and many of you believe, and I believe it as well. I want you to understand that, and that is this: God is love. God is a loving God. But to say God is love is like saying the universe is big. It doesn't describe much. It's one aspect of who God is. And people who say God is love at times say, since God is a loving God would never judge. If somebody sins, God loves them, and he could never send them to an eternity in hell for doing that, because I wouldn't do that. And if I wouldn't do that, then God wouldn't do it either, you see. And then we have this fatherhood of God, brotherhood of man kind of attitude. God just loves us. God just wants us all to be saved, which is true. But this forgets God is holy. God is pure. God is perfect. And if we excuse God's actions and say he's love, and we forget that Jesus Christ died for a reason, that he died on the cross because we need him, then we question who God is. We question what the Word of God says, and we end up in a difficult place. That's why preachers who regularly shout slogans instead of bringing you to the Word of God, who say nice things instead of bringing you to Scripture, worry me. We have to make sure that we get our theology from the Word, not from slogans. And we need to take that very seriously. So we bring ourselves back full circle to the question, how do we live as free people without using our freedom as a cover-up for evil and sin? We need to be responsible with the authority that God has given us. God says, I love you, I've chosen you, but I've given you responsibility. Do the right thing. Use your free will in a positive way. Represent me in the world. When people see you, they say, that guy's crazy. He loves Jesus, and he won't go out drinking with us and get drunk. I don't know why, but I know he loves Jesus. Become people who follow kingdom culture and not the culture of the people around you. The Corinthians were not that different from us. They were highly affected by their own pop culture, and they acted it out. And we need to make sure that we rub off on the rest of the world, and the rest of the world does not rub off on us. And we need to recognize sin in our daily lives and confess it and turn away from it. Now, I want you to understand, this is not a teaching about you being a bad person. This is not a teaching about you becoming a better person, because you can buy self-help books for that. But we cannot become better people unless we have Christ. None of us can do anything that will make our lives better, to make us more acceptable before God, if we don't have Christ as our Savior, and he does not forgive us. Yesterday, my wife and I had the opportunity, the privilege of going up to Jungfraujoch. And if you know Jungfraujoch, you know it's one of the highest places in the Swiss Alps. It's beautiful. It's carved into a mountain. And on one side, you can look and see down towards Thun and towards Grindelwald. And on the other side, you have millions of tons of snow pressing down into ice and forming this glacier that just goes for miles and miles and miles. It's amazing to see. It's incredible. And inside the building, you have the world's highest watch shop. You have a chocolate shop called Chocolate Heaven. And you have a gift shop selling all sorts of highly prized items like postcards and cowbells. Now I can tell you, when I was there, I spent very little time inside looking at the things you could buy. Because what God made on the outside was absolutely amazing. It was beautiful. It was incredible to see and experience, to walk on the glacier, to touch the snow, to see the size and the immensity of everything. And what I want to say to you today is this: live as people who are free. Do not use your freedom as a cover-up for sin. And live as servants of God. Because what I saw yesterday inside that building was nothing compared to what was on the outside. And in our lives, we tend to go towards the worldly things. We tend to go towards money and success and things that may please us for a short period of time instead of what God has made. It was so much better to be outside and see what God had created than what was inside. And I challenge you today to believe again that God has better for you. God has better for me than what I can work on my own, that what I can chase after, what the world has to offer me. Let's pray. Father God, thank you that you are amazing. Thank you that your understanding of our lives is better than we know ourselves. You choose to give us free will, Lord. You choose to allow us to make mistakes because you love us and you're willing to forgive us. And we're so thankful for that. We're so thankful there is a way to find forgiveness. And as we leave tonight, Lord, and as we go home, we want to be more like you. We want to use our freedom in a good way to bless you and honor you. Lord, thank you for your gift. Thank you for your love. And thank you for making us your sons and daughters. Amen.